Hi there, and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined. I was very lucky for him to return to land a day earlier than I had planned. I am joined by, how do you describe him? It's Sharky Fossil. Welcome to the show.
Ahoy, how are you doing?
I'm very excited for this one. I'm glad that you've like I said, touched down on land and got your land legs.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I've been preparing quite a lot for this podcast here. I've actually been taking what are known as landlubber lessons, which teach me to communicate efficiently and effectively as a landlubber. So I'm going to be putting to use everything that I've learned through that, and hopefully I'll be able to pass as a landlubber for your audience today. But you know, if I slip up at any point, you've got to forgive me. I hate landlubbers. I hate them with all my heart, and imitating them pains me to no end, but I'll do my bloody best. So yeah, we'll see how it goes.
I appreciate that so much. I forgot to say before we hit record, I don't mind if we slip in some swear words there. I don't mind. My only concern is if you start maybe getting a bit riled up and raised, maybe try and keep them to a minimum at that point. But you know, it doesn't matter. It's an explicit podcast, even though I haven't actually checked that box in any of the
last. Have I sworn already? Have I done it already?
No, not at all. I just realized I haven't actually asked you that. Because usually it's my other rule, which we were just rushing through, because like I say, you thankfully fit me into your busy schedule after I absolutely cocked up our scheduled recording day for this. So the first question is always the same. It's the cliched wrestling podcast question. It's nice and simple. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that got you hooked on wrestling?
Oh boy, I can never remember a specific moment, to be honest. I mean, like, when I think back, I think of like having wrestling figures, and I think it's wrestling figures that got me into wrestling itself. I remember the first ever figures I bought, which I think every kid had. It was a double set, and it was Hulk Hogan and Goldberg, and he had like magnets on their hands. So you press their legs together and they lift up like that kind of thing. I had that, and that got me into watching a little bit of WCW and Channel 5. And then got into the WWE. I think I properly got into wrestling probably post-invasion era. So kind of Ruthless Aggression kind of stuff. So that's like my time. And then just like characters at the Hurricane really got me into things. And at the time, Kurt Angle, I loved, Rey Mysterio, all the kind of colourful kind of characters basically. And I've just been kind of watching it ever since.
I love that. I remember those figures, the magnet ones. I think I ended up having a Raven. I think I had a Raven.
DVD,
I think was the other one I had. They click together with their fists.
And they do rough each other up, which is what happens in wrestling, right? That's how you do a move, yeah.
Exactly. I mean, I'm sure I've seen it.
By the knuckles, yeah.
I'm glad that you said Channel 5, because every time I mention it, like, people don't seem to remember that Worldwide was on Channel 5. And
that's right,
I thought it was like a Mandela effect by this point. I made it up.
Do you remember when they used to hit each other with a weapon and like the kind of like the Batman like pow came up, or like wham, because you couldn't actually show it on TV, so it's like the comic style like kind of onomatopoeia. There's a word for you.
Yeah. Oh, big word. That's the landlubber license paying off.
I've been reading my dictionary. Yeah, it's great.
I remember that. It was hilarious. And even though if you go back and watch it now and you see the chair shots, if it was Hogan or that, it was. It didn't really constitute needing to do that, because if you hit someone with that much strength, you weren't really going to do much at all, because Hogan was a chair shot taker or
exactly that.
So you mentioned you came just after the invasion, which must be kind of weird then, because when you came in, the figures that you had, they weren't there.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that. Like I've got like a massive collection of wrestling figures when I was a kid. Like I was very fortunate, but my two favorite figures to kind of play with were Booker T and Mike Awesome, who were both there after the invasion, sort of. Booker T more so. Mike Awesome was just kind of in the background, I guess. But so they were both there, so I was loving it. But I had like your DDPs, and I had your all the WBF guys as well. So everyone I had as a figure was there, apart from your Goldbergs and Hogans and stuff like that. But they came later, didn't they?
Eventually. So who are your favorites then growing up? Say you played your Booker T's and your Mike Awesome's. Were they kind of your guys are who your favorites when you start.
Yeah, Booker T was a big one. Yeah, Kurt Angle. Try to think now who I enjoyed growing up. The Hurricane was a big one. I was a massive mark for the Hurricane. I just like one of my most fondest memories was his storyline with The Rock. You know, the kind of mini feud they had, and just the segments were perfect, with The Rock being the biggest heel in the world and Hurricane just being this zany kind of superhero babyface. It was like the perfect combination, and I just remember being so bloody happy when the Hurricane beat The Rock, to the extent where I asked my mother if I could dye my hair green, and she said no. But yeah, so never happened. But I got a t-shirt from it, so yeah.
that is dedication, if it ever was.
That's it, yeah.
I remember going, I went to a SmackDown show in Aberdeen in 2008. I think it was, because it was SmackDown. I was like, well, I'm going to dye my hair blue.
That's nice. What that's how you fit in, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. That's how people will know I'm going to SmackDown. And
yeah,
I was told, no, you can't dye it. So I found this kind of like gel pate stuff that like tinged your hair blue instead.
And oh, like, right.
That'll do. There we go.
You can wash it out after, kind of thing, yeah.
That's when I had hair. It was a long time ago.
Yeah. Like I'm still trying. I'm still fighting a violent battle myself, clinging onto it. So I feel your pain.
I don't mind if it receded like that way. I wouldn't have minded, but it started at the center here.
Oh, so mate, same.
There's no recovery from that.
I only bloody realized this as well very, very recently, because I was in a match in Source Wrestling, and I remember there was a point where my head's down facing the camera, and I'm like seeing the top of my head, and I'm like, shit, I'm balding there. it's the first time I noticed. You never get a view of the top of your head. You never actually think of that, you know. So it was that was a bombshell for me.
mine was on the Murray Firth Radio website, because I was doing a radio course, and I was filling in the forms, and had photos like, these are the new candidates, and there was my head down filling in this form, and I was like, oh no, that is good. We had our photos worse that day for like our profiles. So I had a big head of hair, I had my beard, and then I came in the day after they were all done, shaven. It was gone.
Yeah.
And I was like, no, now I see it cannot stay there.
Got to bite the bullet. Yeah. Actually, I did that during lockdown, you know, the period of lockdown when you weren't going to see anybody. I shaved my head and just see what it looked like. So it's if I ever do need to take that plunge, I'm pretty confident I can pull it off. So we're okay.
It's a good look. It's a very common look. It's fashion. I think it's fashionable.
That's it. Yeah.
The beard
makes you look hard, right? That's it. Yeah.
Exactly. and then they speak to me and they go, "Oh, he's probably beat him up quite easily." Anyway, so Hurricane. I loved his storyline with Rosie, the superhero.
Oh, the shit. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. SHIT. Yeah. That's right. He was great as well, and he had a great storyline with Jamie Noble and Nydia at one point in time, and. He was just like the great kind of the perfect mid-carder, really. He's very easy to support. The fans are always behind him, and bloody underrated wrestler as well. The amount of like moves he pulled out, he's kind of like Chris Kanyon in that sense, where he just like does so many moves, but you don't see him as that kind of like innovative kind of wrestler, but he absolutely was. I love a bit of Gregory Helms. Yeah.
Well, I mean, when you have a song named after one of your moves, it's quite a cool thing with the old Vertebreaker. Anyway, this isn't the Hurricane podcast. This is about Sharky Fossil himself. So how did you go from that, watching it as a youngin, to actually just like trying it yourself?
It was actually my good friend Tyler who came to me with the idea of going to a wrestling school. And so he is going back a few years now, but he messaged Joe Hendry about wrestling training in Edinburgh, and Joe replied saying that he was planning on opening his own school soon. So I guess I owe Tyler a lot, to be honest, because there's no chance that I would have taken the beginner's class like on my Todd. Truth be told, I've always had a degree of anxiety when it comes to being in like large groups, which is what kept me from pursuing wrestling earlier. So it was good to have a friend to tag along with. The longer I spent in the school, the more comfortable I got, and feel really privileged to be part of such an awesome group of people. It's kind of how it all came together. Yeah.
So we'll dive into that a little bit more in a bit. We'll kind of roll back a little bit. So message Joe Hendry, your Tyler, yeah. did. And were you aware of like the UK scene by that point? Were you going to shows? Were you just aware of it at all?
So I'd been to a few Fear and Loathings. So I forget the actual years, but I mean, there's a few years in a row. One year they had like Kurt Angle versus Joe Coffey in the main event. And then there was one with the Dudleys and RVD and Rey Mysterio. And then I'm kind of like, these are probably multiple events I'm thinking of, but there's Kevin Nash came over, Finn Balor came over at one point. And I was at a few of those shows in the front row. Yeah. Ricochet was one of them. He came over and put on an awesome match. So I was like, I was vaguely aware of it, yeah, from watching ICW. And I used to, like way back when, I used to watch ICW on YouTube when they had all their episodes on YouTube back in the day. So it was mainly through ICW that I knew the British scene, yeah.
So the Hydro shows, I think that was all the ones.
Hydro, yeah, that was yeah. Exactly Hydro, that's it, yeah. Great shows.
Lost your first split second there, but we've got you back.
I'm here.
Yeah, so the Hydra shows were the ones that you were aware of with ICW. So there's a couple of names then, of course, you would have been aware of. Joe Hendry obviously being one of them that point, because he came in on his Hendry ball. That was the ABC or something like that. I can't remember. My microphone's deciding to try and fall at this moment in time, so I'm holding it.
I wasn't there, and yeah. Yeah, I wasn't there in person for that, but I do remember that was all over Twitter and Reddit, right? That impressive feat of balance pretty cool, yeah, cool entrance.
It's one of those things where you keep looking back and going, there is a very slim margin of error that he could have just ended up in the first couple of rows.
Ramp. In the crowd. Yeah, he's he had one shot, one opportunity, and he nailed it. Yeah.
So first day training, then you and Tyler go down, yep. And of course, like you say, you're a bit anxious in big groups. Same, I absolutely get that. This is why I do my interviews on Zoom and not face to face, because you know the interview's over once I hit end meeting. It's great. So what was that first couple sessions like then? How did you find it?
Yeah, it was good. No, everyone in school was like dead friendly. It was Joe and Dave, Conrad are fantastic coaches. You know, they're very welcoming, very, you know, it's very good for beginners kind of thing. There's like certain things that wouldn't get right first time, and they weren't too pushy about it. It's like, don't worry, try this again, try this, try that, try this. So yeah, very, very good for that. The first few sessions were great. It's just like, lockups, wrist locks, that kind of stuff, taking bumps for the first time. So the first few sessions were just kind of gave me that appreciation of like how difficult wrestling can be. Having watched it on the telly for many, many years, like you don't obviously it looks difficult, but you know, you wouldn't expect a lockup to be something you had to like actually think about, you know. So it was eye-opening as well, yeah.
It's one of those weird things, right, where it's always called like a collar and elbow tie-up, and it takes you quite a long time to look to go, oh yeah,
it's a collar, why. It's the elbow, yeah.
that's why it's called that, obviously.
Makes sense.
You just hear Jim Ross saying it all these years, and you go, okay, cool, it is collar and elbow. Collar and elbow, and you know, put it all together into one word. Who's in your kind of first couple classes that are still about? Because there's a good core, especially when the lockdown happened, which at some point, I'm sure, that there was a lot of new faces popping up and being introduced. So who was in your first couple of classes?
First couple of classes. So we had Judas Gray. So he was there from the first class. We had James Erdos. He was there from the first class. Who else was there? Jareth Duke. He's not debuted yet, but he will very soon. He was there in the first class. Awesome Rob was there in the first class, and I really feel like I'm missing somebody out, and I'm very sorry. I'm blanking at the moment. Dean Mack, who was around for a short while, he was in the first class, and then I think the rest, unfortunately, left. Yeah.
I think Mr. Manville was there. I think he was the second or third.
He came in like a few weeks after with Big Chez and Ryan Richards and all the rest. Yeah, but the first class was just a few of us. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I mean, and now that you guys are making your debut, at least the vast majority of the names you just mentioned in that first class. So what were we looking at year-wise? Was that just the end of 2019, start of 2020?
So September 2019, I believe. Yeah, so a good 6 months before the world ended. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So when you started your training then with Joe, obviously I don't need to get all the secrets and the ins and outs, because you pay your money for your intake, so that's how you get taught these things. But he's obviously a very talented wrestler where he could do just about anything with the wrestling, power, strength, and character, which is everything you kind of, it's your dream package. Was he kind of good for focusing on what everyone's strengths were? For example, if you're not kind of getting the wrestling portion down, he'll concentrate on character stuff to kind of get you up to level with everyone else. How did you find his teaching style?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, he definitely does that. He does play into your strengths. I mean, like one thing that's not 10 out of 10 for me is technical wrestling. So Joe would focus on teaching me some quote unquote big man stuff, because I'm 6'4, 6'5. So, was obviously my strength. And doing like, watching, advising me to watch Undertaker, watch guys like Test, watch guys like Albert, you know, that kind of stuff, and like taking what they're doing in the ring. So, he does, although there is like one lesson for the whole class on most days, it's like he does like break it down into little kind of chunks so everyone has their own individual kind of thing to work on, basically. Yeah,
that's a pretty good way of like making sure that if he's putting out, say, a showcase show, if that's ever to happen, it's not all just six matches of Johnny Kickpads doing the exact same thing.
Exactly. Yeah, you get variety. There's a huge variety between the guys in our school. Loads and loads of different styles, like Judas Gray does flips and stuff, you know, and he's very kind of high flying to that extent, whereas you got Erdos, who's very technical based, and everyone refs with a different kind of style. So it's a good old variety we have there, for sure.
So September 19, you started, and you got a couple, like I said, about 6 months in, and then that was it. The world was over. Apparently a bat was eaten at some point, and sliding doors happened, and we all ended up stuck in our own houses for.
That's right. Yeah.
So when that happened, a lot of the guys from the Joe Henry School, I spoke to Manival about it when we were saying that it's probably going to be a couple of weeks. Okay, we'll get some promo videos out and just introduce the characters, kind of thing, or introduce everyone. And then it just didn't stop. Mm. So how did you feel putting together Sharky Fossil, just getting all the pieces together? What was that kind of journey like?
Yeah, it was good. It was Joe was he was great with us over lockdown. He could have easily just like shut everything down and said, right, see you when this is all over, but he kept in contact with us. He did like regular classes with us online through Zoom, and just looked after us, basically helped us develop our characters. Like, obviously we couldn't develop anything physically, like in the ring or anything like that, but he helped us, like like I said, get into our characters, and we'd done like promo classes and all of the rest, and like he had like he would arrange calls of us where we can kind of flesh out our characters with him. So doing that was it's one of the things that kept me sane during lockdown, to be honest. You gotta have a lot of people found a project during lockdown, and that was mine, I guess, like building Sharky Fossil. And putting out the videos was great. It was great to kind of have the video out there and see people liking them and commenting on it and saying, oh, he's a pirate, that's really cool, all that kind of stuff. It helped us out big time. When we couldn't do stuff in the ring, to actually just develop our characters and have that ready for when we can go back in the ring.
So when it came to the pirate himself, we've got questions about it, which we'll get to as well, but was there any inspirations in particular for that, or was it just Jean-Pierre Lafitte and Paul Burchill? I can't think of any more pirates off the top of my head that are wrestlers at the same time, but was it more a wrestling inspiration, or was there just what inspired Sharky Fossil?
Yeah, other than the fact that I am a pirate, of course, that was probably the main inspiration. Paul Burchill, absolutely. He was a big fan of him growing up. His character was very, very short-lived, unfortunately, but like for what it was, like I don't know if you remember his entrance, but he had the rope at the side of the entrance ramp, and he kind of flew in, which I thought was the most badass thing ever. You know, so yeah, I guess that was it. And just wanted to kind of try something unique. There's not many pirates in wrestling today, you know, so it's like something that I can maybe sort of make my own kind of thing. So that's kind of what led to the decision to become Sharky Fossil. Yeah.
So yeah, there's a lot of captains going around, but yeah, no pirates, so to speak.
No.
I think it may be one in the whole of the UK that possibly, but that'll just be off the top of my head. So you've unleashed your real life as Sharky Fossil into the world, and you got to put your character out there. Got to do the promos and what have you, but then of course lockdown kept happening and yes, going, and some continued to put out regular videos, like Ryan Richards. He put out one, I think, just about once a fortnight.
He was great. He was on it. Yeah.
Lucky.
Yeah.
But others maybe just kind of took a step back to kind of just reevaluate, and just didn't want people sick of them before they even made their debut, I suppose. In that respect, at the same time, so. Of course, saw the first couple of promos, and there's a lot. I think a lot has changed. It's evolved in that time. How? There was no question. I started rambling, and I haven't really thought about
it. Just making a point here. Yeah.
Really. So yeah. So a lot of pirate lore is used in your promos. Again, is this just another interest that you have? Is it just are you just fascinated by just pirates and that kind of stuff?
There's not many things in the world that are cooler than pirates, right? I mean, everyone's into pirate kind of lore these days. You've got Sea of Thieves going around. You've got like a million pirate TV shows. It's very interesting. You can really kind of find out some really cool stuff with it. And in regards to what you're saying about the promos as well, like it was good to just get the reps in that regard. That's what Ryan Richards was doing, as you say, every week. And now you look at his stuff now, and it's absolutely fantastic. And he's on Discovery, he's on Main Event and Source, he's doing all these great things. So so that period was just great to get used to cutting promos, and then to become the more refined versions of ourselves, which we are now.
Absolutely. So we do have some questions in, so we'll just throw some in at this point, because there's loads. You're very popular on the old Twitter. Right, so we've got Major Matt Wolf. Of course, I think we're hoping to have him on before the end of the season to return, because I think he needs some redemption after the Shambles episode, which I can't revisit because it was not my finest interview in the world. I was so confused by having three people on at the same time. He has asked, who is the greatest ever pirate captain?
Greatest ever pirate captain? I mean, I could be modest and pay tribute to the Blackbeards of the world and the William Kidds and the Henry Morgans, but let's be honest, it's me, Sharky Fossil.
Fair enough. What are the dimensions for the oft-referenced plank?
Oh, 32 inches long, 8 inches wide, with a depth of 3 inches. You want to use oak wood for that as well. Trust me, I've tried pine wood, but it does not do the job. Oak is the one you need for that. Yeah,
I love that answer. Right. So, speaking of the plank, you actually have your own dedicated music. We've got the Walk the Plank. So, how was that put together? And explain how we got to Walk the Plank, because the whole music video ensemble.
Yeah. So that was me recording with my friend Fraser, who has a studio in Armadale called Where a Fox My Studio. It's kind of Aylstorm inspired. So I wrote the whole thing myself, and you can hear me singing on it. It's just about getting down one afternoon, seeing what I could do, and then came up with that, and that is now my bespoke entrance music.
So is music another kind of side project that you like, or was this just more of a one-off thing?
I've been in bands, I play guitar, I do a bit of everything kind of things. So yeah, I've got my own kind of music career going on at the same time. I've got so many things going on elsewhere. It's like many I wear many hats, basically.
One of which obviously being a pirate hat.
Yeah, of course.
So speaking of that, then your voice is, for those that are listening may have heard your voice before on other podcasts. So we've got a podcast called Making Kayfabe.
We do.
And I've seen the concept of it. I've listened to a few episodes, and I think it's so interesting. Because of course, podcasts, I mean, like this is a niche of a niche of a niche, because it's interviewing, but it's Scottish wrestling. So you have to be kind of dedicated to Scottish wrestling if you're wanting to listen to some of these episodes. Whereas Making Kayfabe, it's a bit more of a wider world, but at the same time, it's still quite a niche, fancy booking kind of thing. So how did that come about?
Yeah, so yeah, in my of course, in my efforts to convince people about the landlubberness, I do have a podcast, Making Kayfabe, but that all came together about just so like there's a lot of it's about wanting to do something different, I guess. There's a lot of podcasts out there which, you know, let's talk about last night's Raw, and let's talk about the recent pay-per-view. And like me and my friend Dylan wanted to do something different. And we have a background in, I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but e-fedding. I don't know if you're aware of that.
I remember e-fedding, yes.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's it. You're of the age of e-fedding. Yes. Yeah. which was... How do you make it not so nerdy? You know,
it's not possible.
There's no real way. But it is effectively, it's like an online writing competition. I think that's the least nerdy way to put it. Yeah, we had a lot of experience with that, with writing all these like unique storylines, and like we thought, like you know, that was for an audience of maybe like five people on the same forum. So we're thinking we could probably do something bigger here. And you know, we started recording Making Kayfabe, and yeah, where we are today is looking, we've got our own cool little community, which is awesome. And the people who regularly check in for episodes and comment on them and retweet us. And it's a really cool thing. Something like we both really enjoy doing, like from the writing to the, you know, to the actual recording, and not the editing part, but everything else is great. Yeah, the editing is never fun. You run a podcast, you know this.
I mean, my editing is not editing. That's pretty much it. I mean, I like to keep it as in my head, I like to say keep it as natural as possible, so we get the M's and the R's, but really I just don't want to do it. So unless we drop it, like literally if one of us drops out and comes back in, I'll do a fade out and then fade back in. That's nice. About all I've got. That's my editing skills in a
nutshell. That's an expert technique right there. That's it.
There you go. Just a fade to. I mean, I use Windows Movie Maker. I have used the oldest equipment and oldest tech.
Ah, mate, I love Windows. I used to use that for my in the very very early days. I used Windows Movie Maker for my promos. You know, so I've recently switched to. I've forgotten the way the initials are. I think it's VSDC. I think it's called, which has got a few more kind of like bells and muscles. But Windows Movie Maker, man, that was a shit. That's all you need most of the time.
I know. I keep thinking, I'll use something else. But now at this point, like I've been saying to folks, this is episode 155. I plan to finish at 165. So I'm like, how's the point of trying something else now when I've got 10, 11 more episodes to record? Pointless.
That's it. Why not just buy yourself an Adobe package right now for the last 10? Yeah,
exactly.
It's no point. Yeah,
yeah, absolutely pointless. So when you come, you're a very multi talented man. Between the not sorry to blow smoke up your backside there, but
please continue. Flattery will get you everywhere. Yeah.
So between being a wrestler, doing the promos, music, and the writing, and everything, how do you make time for yourself at this point? Because it seems you're like you're saying, you've got so many, lack of a better phrase, so many fingers and so many pies. You just like to try a bit of everything.
I think that's pretty much it in regards to how do I find the time. I mean, you've seen it today with how late I was for this interview. So you know, I find the time by just like hoping that I'll get something done quicker than I will, and then I eventually don't. But yeah, it's just I like to keep myself busy, I guess. You know, like I guess like sometimes when I'm sitting doing nothing, I feel guilty for not doing something. So it's like I've got to, you know, get something done. So yeah, there's always something going on. Yeah, and it keeps keeps life exciting. Yeah.
Did you find that maybe pre-lockdown that you were guilty of doing that, of just maybe not making your hours count for the day? So you made a concerned effort to go, right, what can I do today? Or I can do something, about the podcast. I can get an idea going, or I can watch Undertaker match and get some ideas of what I could do
Exactly. Yeah. There's always a plan for the day. Like today, I'm going to do X, Y, and Z, and then you know that's kind of me happy for the day because I can then sit down at 11 o'clock at night and say, oh, I've done an interview with Billy today. I've been to the gym. I've done you know a bit of writing. So you know it's very kind of a fulfilling kind of fills the heart kind of thing for being relaxed in the evening. Yeah.
So we won't dive so much into the podcast side of things because everyone can go check out making Kayfabe podcast. There'll be plenty of ways and plenty of back catalogs. You know, it's six series now.
We are in season six. Yeah, we're two episodes into season six. Yeah.
But before we go away from it, what's been your most? If people are listening to this, going right, I need to go check that out. What story arc or which episode would you go? This sums up the Making Kayfabe podcast quite nicely.
You've asked us at a very great time because we've just had our listeners rate our top five episodes. So you know, we took
almost like I planned this.
Yeah, here you go. It's perfect. the number one top episode was King Regal. So rebooking the Regal King of the Ring run, you know, in a situation where he didn't maybe, you know, get suspended and that all went to shit. So it's kind of like that's imagining what would happen if he actually went for the world title after the King of the Ring and just became a main eventer, you know. Other than that, the next most popular episodes are Keith Lee. And so booking him in WWE, there's the Sean O'Hare, which is you know another one from the old Ruthless Aggression era who didn't get a fair shake. John Cena heel turn, and the Right to Censor is a classic as well. So you know, but honestly, with the podcast, you can dive into any episode that you take most interest in. There's no kind of running storyline in between episodes. Every episode self-contained. So if you want to go listen to the recent Cody Rhodes episodes, then you can do that. There's nothing, you don't need to have listened to everyone to listen to that, if that makes sense. But there's something there for everyone, you know, every era of wrestling. So just have a look, dive in, and see what you fancy.
So I'm going to go back to e-threading because you mentioned it. I'm always
how often
intrigued.
Do you get to talk about that?
not as often as I hoped.
What not as often as you should.
Exactly. So were you a message board e-feder or I was a Bebo e-feder?
A Bebo e-feder?
I was on Bebo.
I didn't know Bebo did it. I was definitely a Bebo-er, but we were a message board e-fed called the EWA, which was... I think it's like it's still going these days, believe it or not. It's one of the longest running e-feds online. I think it was started in like 2001 or something. It's still going today, which is insane. But yeah, that's where I did most of my writing. Yeah.
And did you unleash your pirate persona at that point? Was it always in the back of your mind, or
so?
Who were you?
It's funny. So it was actually a. So the thing with the CFED was you would play actual wrestlers, but you didn't have to like stick to their like trademark mannerisms, or you know, didn't have to play The Rock like The Rock. You know, you can like you could make like Funaki a hitman or something, right? You could get a fun with it, basically. So it's actually funny you bring this up because during lockdown, I dipped myself back into e-fedding into the EWA, and I played a character, Oni Lorcan, who I renamed as One Eye Lorcan, who had a pirate gimmick. So like, it kind of like that helped me in a way to get more ideas from a pirate character as Sharky Fossil. So it helped in a way to, you know, kind of flesh out what Sharky Fossil was by playing this fictional One Eye Lorcan character. Yeah.
That is incredible. I was like some sort of weird. I mean, I never really listened to Insane Clown Posse, but I was some sort of a psycho clown, and I called myself
Nice.
It was a very terrible name at the time because I was too innocent to realize it. But I called myself the Dean. That was my name.
Right.
I didn't realize it what it meant. I was only like 14 maybe, and I was like, and the more I think about it, going. Why did nobody tell me this part? That is a terrible name.
I think it's very much the jokes on you here kind of thing. Like, just it's funny when he doesn't realize. Yeah,
I know. I just imagine just all the Bebo DMs all laughing, going, "Look at this idiot calling himself."
Not at all.
Calling himself the Bean.
Yeah. No, man. It's. I mean, you know yourself. It's so much fun to just like just. Create this character and mold it into whatever you want, and then have the competition with other people. It's like it's a lot of fun. Like there's so many times where I think like you know, I'd love to get back into that, but it also just takes so much of your time up as well. Mm-hmm. You know, and like I said, there's only 24 hours in a day. So, but yeah, I think I will go back to it at one point. It's too fun to miss out on it for too long, I think.
I mean, like you're saying, it's just a nice creative outlet. So, I mean, you can...
Yeah, exactly.
You can test some of your family history of the previous generations of fossils and what have you. And if it doesn't work, you go, right, that's fine. I don't need to do that in front of a crowd. I've tested it. So, next thing. If something pops off and people are going nuts for it, you're like, great, now I can bring that to a wider audience. It's...
Exactly.
I think it's probably an underrated or unappreciated form. I mean, it is still, like you said right at the start, speaking about e-fedding, it's very nerdy. And
I just love being able to talk about it. It's not very often I get to chat about this. You know, I've read them with my co-host who is also an e-fedder. So, you know, I think I remember OSW Review, they mentioned it in one of their episodes a couple of months back. I was like, oh my God, e-fedding.
I used to e-fed with old Jay Hunter.
Did you?
Yeah, well,
oh man,
OSW Review, I mean, MJ V1 and well, would be Neil at the time, they had their World Bounce Wrestling, but there were Jay was also a modder at Old School Wrestling Chat, it was called, on Bebo and then Facebook. Wow. And I was the other mod.
I didn't know that.
It was me, a guy called Davin Malloy, and Jay Hunter. We were the three mods for it.
And then
he went to do OSW Review. Excellent. He was still kind of modding as well. I went and did OSW TV, which nobody listened to because everyone thought I was supposed to be Irish. And then I changed it to SWN, and here we are.
So, right. I might have not known that. That's fantastic.
It's my only claim to fame to OSW Review. I think there's a very early episode where my name's in the credits as well. It's great, but also it's because I was with that. I got engaged at the time, not with my wife now. So it's very bittersweet to look back on it and go, oh, that's... see the names on it, like, ah, shit.
Oh, man, like, I couldn't be happy for those guys, honestly. Like, Jay actually helped us out big time with starting the podcast and giving us, like, you know, the kind of pro tips for podcasting. And then, last year, he actually retweeted our kind of what is making kayfabe video. And we got so many listeners from that, which was just so cool of him. He's like, there must be like millions of people messaging him. Like, how do I do podcasting? How do I do it? And he gets back to you. Like, he's just, it's like you're saying here, like, how do you find the time? How does he find the time to do that? And edit these massive episodes of OSW and like do all these awesome things that he does. But he is, total legend, and couldn't be happy for the guy. He's clearly very successful. Good on him.
But yeah, I mean, if you could retweet one of mine once in a while, that'd be nice. But you know, you tagged him in the big demo one. Damn, that's
right, exactly. Yeah, next time,
do
the Sharky Fossil one.
Exactly. I'll tag him in it. Hopefully, Joe get in there because he is quite into the indie stuff. He's doing a lot of stuff. Tweeting Martina and all that kind of stuff, so you know.
That's right, yeah. He's I think him and Martina have got a bit of a kind of a thing going on, yeah. He's like, they're very close, yeah.
He's only human.
That's it, exactly.
So we'll jump back in some more of the questions, then we'll finally get to you actually making your England debut. We'll get there.
Okay.
And we've got my stupid questions to ask everyone, but we've got, let's see, we'll go for Mr. Manival. Of course, past guests on the podcast, if people want to listen to it. You can listen to the Shambles episode if you want, but that's entirely your hope and thoughts to do so. Sharky, what's your favourite Cher song circa 87 to 91?
Well, Billy, I'm sure you'd agree that it would be easy to just answer If I Could Turn Back Time from Cher's 1989 19 studio album Heart of Stone, but there's so much more to share than just her hits. I mean, take the album I just mentioned, Heart of Stone. The album had five quote-unquote singles, but when you look under the hood, when you really deep dive into the absolute peak of Cher's career, you find incredibly well-written and crafted songs such as Emotional Fire, which is the example I'm going to use today. Emotional Fire is an ear-grabbing classic which just doesn't get enough love, whether it's the roaring Richie Sambora-esque guitar riff to open the song, the intense backing vocals from undeniable pop legends Bonnie Tyler or Michael Bolton, or Cher's emotional voice as she sings. My heart is burning with the heat of this emotional fire every time I see you. I'm on fire every time we touch. Can't you feel me burning with desire? Baby, feel warm. Give me some emotional fire. Emotional fire. It's all just utterly sensational and a track that should not be taken lightly. And Billy, I could go on and on about Cher's career circa 87 to 91. I haven't even scratched the surface on her second self-titled album in 1987 or the platinum-selling Love Hurts from 1991. But I appreciate we don't have the time for that today. But if you want to host a follow-up podcast where Mr. Manivo and I speak about the legacy of Cher, specifically between 1987 and 1991, I would be all for that.
Maybe one of those podcasts where I just let you guys start and I would just leave the room and just let you guys, and I come back in about an hour or so, and every time, maybe every so often for the video listeners, I'll pop in with like a bowl of cereal or something and just make sure that it hasn't gone totally off the rails.
You'll come in an hour in and it'll still be 8 hours to go. Yeah.
You'll just be finished the first album at that point.
Of course, yeah.
I mean, people hate it. I like Believe, even though it killed music. Even though that's not, I know that's not 87.
How did it kill music? Hold on a minute. How did that kill music? That made music. That gave birth to music somehow.
It gave birth to a certain kind of music, which I did not care for.
Aye, fucking point. Bangers. Yeah. Sorry, sore. You can bleep that.
No. It's this state. I like the emotion, the absolute passion that you have for Cher.
big mark for Cher. Big mark.
I hope it went. I mean, of course, you did the music video where she was on a cannon and next to nothing. Mm. Is that a Sharky Fossil promo in the future? If you can get hands on
It's part of the genesis of Sharky Fossil, actually. So yeah, it would be you know, wrong to not pay tribute to it at some point. So yeah, I think that's on the cards. Yeah,
right. I've got to scroll down from Mr. Manville's question because he's got a Cher gif and it's just I can't get my eyes off it now because it just keeps going.
We can talk more about Cher if you want. I'm more than happy to.
I'm sure you are, but we've got more questions to ask, so we'll move on for the moment. Who knows, we've got a bit of time left. I'm sure we'll come back to Cher at some point, because you know it's Cher. Tyler Mortimer,
yeah, sure.
Of course. Tyler, I'm assuming this is your friend that dragged you to your first training session.
It is my friends. It is indeed.
Is to blame for Sharky Fossil into the world.
Yeah, exactly.
He has asked, what happened with the Dolphins and Davey? Sounds like you're carrying some real trauma.
I'm assuming that Tyler is referring to my matey, Lazy Eye Landon. And it's quite a sensitive subject, actually, Billy. But yeah, I'll go into the story. So it was Lazy Eye Landon who was ultimately claimed by Davy Jones. And this happened from Summer's Day. Lazy Eye and I, we got bored, man. There isn't really a whole lot you can do when you're sailing in the middle of the ocean, you know? There's only so many times you can play I Spy with My Glass Eyes. So imagine our delight when we saw, next to the SS Fossil, two hammerhead sharks. Now, as you'll no doubt know, Billy, hammerhead sharks have never really seen humans as food. They're relatively safe compared to, you know, great whites. So being that there was two hammerhead sharks, Lazy Eye Landon's idea was, hey, let's ride them. So parked our ship in the water. We approached the hammerheads and we're having a great time for all of 3 minutes. But then the Atlantic white-sided dolphin appeared. And Billy, Atlantic white-sided dolphins are ferocious. Anything they see is to be destroyed. There are tales of Atlantic white-sided dolphins killing anything from sea turtles to blue whales to from starfish to jellyfish, from piranhas to orcas. They just decided the dolphin took a chunk out of Lazy Eye's left arm. It was brutal. And then, of course, now smelling Lazy Eye's blood in the water, the hammerhead sharks whipped themselves into a frenzy. They each took one of Lazy Eye's legs, and then, of course, in came the 10-foot octopus, which wrapped itself around Lazy Eye's neck, and I'm sure you can guess the rest. But I I paddle myself to safety, unable to compete with the sheer force of two hammerhead sharks, an Atlantic white-sided dolphin, and a 10-foot octopus, and lazy eye was no more. But let me tell you, do you know how much an Atlantic white-sided dolphin weighs, Billy?
I don't know.
Well, it's 200 kilograms. And though my friend Lazy Eye Landon is no longer with us, I do have a friend named Judas Gray who can deadlift 200 kilograms. And that said, we're going to go out soon and find that a particular Atlantic white-sided dolphin who instigated my friend's death, and it's not going to end well for him at all.
That is an epic tale. I'm sure people will have to
very sad, very sad, very sad. Yeah,
you listen to and find it very, very interesting that the signal start. We got the whole story, but the signal start cutting out in little bits, and I don't know if there's some dolphins nearby.
I wouldn't put it past them, bloody dolphins,
trying to silence you in this tale.
They're the worst things on planet Earth. They really are, especially the Atlantic white-sided ones. Don't get me started. We did get me started, but I'm not going to continue.
Just think of Cher. Think of Cher. Right. Just calm you down.
Oh, that's much better. Yeah, okay.
Speaking of Judas Gray, who's going to come and batter some dolphins in the near future,
yeah.
He has quite a few questions here. So there's some wrestling ones we'll leave towards the end. So first one is, what is the fastest ship to sail in, and what are your thoughts on modern-day ships?
Fastest ship is, of course, the SS Fossil, which was built all the way back in 1917. As for modern-day ships, they just don't compare. Too many silly bells and whistles. You know, pirates never needed a microwave or an instant coffee machine back in 1917, Billy. We had what we had. We made do with what we had. And despite it, we made every journey a success. So, yeah, modern ships, not for me.
Do you find the tale of Captain Jack Sparrow in the Pirates films, do you find that's an accurate portrayal? Oh, this isn't a question from Judas, it's just for me. Do you find his portrayal in the Pirates films to be wholly accurate, or do you find it to be a bit too much?
Who's that?
There we go. Right. Next question. I don't think we've got Disney Plus on the ship, unfortunately. So apologize to anyone who thought we'd get it.
No Wi-Fi, man. No Wi-Fi.
No Wi-Fi. Dolphins. Dolphins are messing up with the Wi-Fi.
Dolphins, yeah.
He's also asked, what's your favourite MCR song?
MCR song? I need to borrow some of his CDs, I think, to answer that one. Let's see. Black Parade. Yeah, Black Parade. That's a belter, isn't it?
Classic.
A bit of a banger. Yeah.
We've got Callum in. Callum Bruce saying, dream match, Shark Boy or Paul Burchill?
Shark Boy or Paul Burchill? Oh, man. As in, who would win or who would I want to win? Or
Who would you face? Who would you want to face?
Oh, sure, it's got to be a triple threat.
Would you go the old Stone Cold, Shell Yeah, Shark Boy iteration?
Oh, Shell Yeah, that's right. And that's a fishing line because Shark Boy said so. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. It's got to be a triple threat. Yeah.
Just go for all of them. Excellent. And I was going to say who would win, but obviously you'd pick Sharky Fossil to be victorious.
Yeah.
Excellent.
I wouldn't pick him. It would just happen. But yeah.
Of course. Okay. Yes. Absolutely. Mm. You got what I meant. Mm. You got my mind there. We've got Ryan at Full On Shindig. Wrestler in training, so I'll just give him a wee follow there as well.
Hey, good on him.
How does life at sea differ from life on land?
There's a lot more water and a lot less concrete. If you want to go down the shop to get, for example, a bottle of rum, you can't do that very easily at sea. It could be hundreds of miles away. So I guess the main difference is water, and lots of it.
Do you have a particular brand of rum, or is it just any?
Just rum, yeah. Rum, yeah.
Fair enough.
Aldi own brand, yeah.
Apparently, I heard that was the next thing. I stayed on vodka. I'm quite happy on that, that brand of spirit. Gin came in and it's still kind of hanging about, but rum seems to be the new thing. So
That's the new craze, yeah. Everyone's getting into rum, but I've been in it for hundreds of years.
Exactly.
So
yeah.
I was the hipster of rum. Yeah, yeah. I had rum before it was cool.
there's a new tagline: the hipster of rum, Sharky Fossil.
That's going right in the Twitter bio.
He's also asked, "What's your favorite sea shanty?" Easy for me to say.
It's hard to name just one, really. I mean, you've got Drunken Sailor, you've got Randy Dandio, you've got Blow the Man Down, you've got Don't Forget Your Old Shipmate, you've got Old Billy Riley, got your name in it, you've got Molly Malone, you've got, oh man, Johnny's Gone to High Low. So you can't pick just one. Any sea shanty is good for me. I'll be happy with any sea shanty on the jukebox.
Wonderful. And can we expect Sharky Fossil merchandise can we expect Sharky Fossil merchandise in the eventual future?
I got the gist of the question.
Good.
you can expect pirate wrestling t-shirts to be distributed very soon. So keep an eye on social media for that one. It is coming.
Excellent. And Ryan's also finally asked, can he be an honorary member of Sharky's pirate crew?
Absolutely. Yeah, come aboard, Ryan. Yeah, your honorary eye patch is in the post. Yeah. Welcome aboard, buddy.
Excellent. So back to Judas Gray's one questions, because they're, I said, actually wrestling related, which is shocking at this stage.
It's very tenuous at this stage, I think.
I know. I think the balance has really shifted into non-wrestling chat and just more piratey. But you know, that's how these podcasts roll. Yeah, usually I always have like a plan. I write down a plan, and then it never goes that way. Right. So first one, loads here. Goals in wrestling.
Goals in wrestling. The ultimate goal. It's a serious answer here, but the ultimate goal is Japan. You know, I want to enter into Japan at one point and wrestle for a Japanese wrestling company. That's where I want to end up. Yeah. So. Hopefully a few years, 5 years in the future, you'll see me there, yeah.
And also get some treasure at the same time.
On the way, exactly, yeah.
So is Japanese wrestling something that you kind of dropped into during your training, or was that something when you were watching WWE or AEW or whatever that you kind of gravitated towards?
Yeah, so it all kind of started. So it was probably... A lot of people probably give you the same answer, but what got me to watch the first New Japan show was Chris Jericho coming in to face Kenny Omega, which was 5 years ago now, I think, right? Five, six, maybe. But yeah, that's what got me to check it out. And I just remember watching that show and just being blown away with just like how, how much of a great alternative it was to WWE, because that's what I was watching back then, basically. It just gave me a new appreciation for wrestling. I saw guys like Ishii, I saw Okada, Tanahashi, Ibushi, just blown away by these 20-minute, epics, which were just so much fun to watch. And I loved the whole strong style thing, and I love, a lot of kind of Japanese things, I guess, I'd love to go there one day and just, have my, head knocked off by a Rowan Lariat or something. Yeah, it'd be great.
Excellent. So Judas also asked, what's your favorite match?
Favorite match, very topical, because it's actually in the G1 2019. It's John Moxley versus Ishii, which is just an absolute war of a match. I don't know if you've seen it yourself.
I've never watched a full match in New Japan.
If you're going to watch one, I'd recommend that one, honestly. It's kind of what kind of like solidified the whole I fucking love this thing, sorry, F-bomb. Like very, very, very passionate about this match. But yeah, just Ishii is probably like my favorite wrestler. Just right now he's just... He's like a brute, basically, but he is quite small at the same time. He wrestles like a heavyweight. He's just, he's amazing at selling. He's amazing at just, getting emotion in a match. But that match with John Moxley, who's also one of my favourites, is just insane. It's like they brawl over the arena. Like, from the second Ishii entered the ring, it's just like, it's intense, you know, and just there's insane spots. There's a Japanese table, of course. You know, it's a classic. So yeah, if you're going to watch one match, Billy, from New Japan, like I definitely recommend that. It's I think on Cage Match, it's like one of like it's both of their highest rated matches of all time. So would 100% recommend that.
I'll bear that in mind. I've hopefully got Ian Skinner coming up again on the podcast, so he'll probably give me a bunch more recommendations. So I think he did about 2 years ago, and I still haven't actually watched any of them.
Ian Skinner, a cool guy, lots of friends.
At least. He somehow, Judas thankfully is a fan because he clearly has listened to past episodes because he's asked least favorite dinosaur. I'm offended by this question, but okay.
I mean, least favorite would be the Loch Ness Monster. You know, that big green bastard almost sunk my ship back in 2006. So, you know, you wonder why he's always hiding. You can never see him. It's because he fears Sharky Fossil. You know, if he brings his head up above water, Sharky will just boot it off. So yeah, it's got to be Nessie. Yeah.
And just to give the flip side, because it's a question we ask everyone anyway, favorite dinosaur?
Luchasaurus.
Nice. I like when people go outside the box for an answer. Wonderful. And
what do you mean? It's a dinosaur. What are you talking about?
I know, but it's like so people go T-Rex, and it's a great dinosaur. I love a T-Rex, but it's like...
A bit basic.
Think great in the box. I can't remember who I was speaking to earlier this week, but their answer was the Indominus Rex from Jurassic World. It's like, there you go, there's an answer.
That's it, that's what you want. Yeah, that's your question.
Something a bit wild and out there.
One that would make you go and Google it. That's the kind of answer you want. Like, you want to go and Google it and find out what it is.
Yeah, absolutely. Now you find out it's a dinosaur that makes itself invisible. There you go.
What? Really?
It's from Jurassic World.
Really? Yeah. Oh, right, of course, right, okay, right, yeah, okay, I'm with
sorry,
you.
Sorry, I got you really excited there about a dinosaur.
Oh, I was so invisible. Looking forward to Googling that, yeah. What? Invisible dinosaurs?
But I apologize, I got you all excited there.
So excited,
that.
Man, like, you're killing my excitement. First share, now invisible dinosaurs, like, it's... Why'd you bring me on here, man?
I like speaking about pirates so at this point. So Judas also asked, favorite passenger every Tuesday?
All right, I'm assuming he's referring to the SS Fossil, which departs Edinburgh to set sail for Bell's Hill every Tuesday. Yeah, there's been many passengers upon the SS Fossil. Some have come, some have gone, some have come and gone and then came back again, but over the last 2 years, there's been one man who has stayed true to the SS Fossil, and that is Judas Gray himself. So, yeah, it's got to be that guy, yeah. He's all right.
Do you have any rules for the SS Fossil when it comes to music, or is it Captain's Choice?
It's strictly Captain's Choice, unless Judas claims to have an absolute banger, which is going to put on the kind of the Bluetooth. So, yeah, occasionally he gets a say in the matter, yeah.
Excellent. And his last one, he asked a lot of questions here, was just some short-term goals. So you mentioned your long-term is Japan. What's your short-term?
Short-term is just to get more reps in, get more bookings. So I've got the taste for kicking landlubbers in the face. So now all I want to do is more of that. So yeah, I guess promoters, if you have someone that you want kicked in the face, then please get in touch at Sharky Fossil on Twitter, sharkyfossil@gmail.com. And I'd be happy to, lend you my boot. Yeah.
Excellent. Right. We're finally about an hour in now. We're going to speak about your actual first match. of course, there's some footage going around in some of your promos, some showcase stuff to get things tight and right and wherever you wanted it to be. But you made your debut, according to my notes, so I could be wrong, at a Source showcase.
Yes.
We've got the 16th of April. It was a six-man tag. It was yourself and Big Chez with Awesome Rob as well. I think Manivel would have been there somewhere, I'm sure.
He couldn't make it that evening, unfortunately.
Oh, he left Big Chez.
He was there in spirit, though. He was there in spirit, yeah.
And you defeated the team of Source Wrestling. It was Leo McLean, Hal Rayner, and Stone Malone, the current Source Wrestling champion.
That's right. That is right.
So what was it like to finally go in front of a crowd, get Sharky Fossil in the ring? What was your thoughts coming into it, and what was your thoughts on the match?
Thoughts going into it, just nerves upon nerves upon nerves. It was very, I was nervous, I was anxious about it all, but honestly, it went really well. The three guys, Harry and Err, Stone Malone, Neil McLean, they're just total professionals, like lovely, lovely, lovely guys, like so easy to planned the match with, and it went match, which I think Leo McLean spoke about on his podcast, which is a shame, but the rest of the match went fantastic. I was very fortunate to have my friends there in the crowd, so they were they kind of had my back, chanting Sharky Fossil in the match, and it was really good to have them there. So I had a bunch of them, and just Chez and Awesome Rob are two very accomplished wrestlers at the same time, so I think minus the end, it went as well as it could have went,
And is that just got you? Because always the first match, it seems, when I'm speaking to people, that's the worst one in your head anyway, because you got to get in and that's you debuting. But after the match ended, were we just like, other than, of course, what happened to Leo, but were you like, right, I said I've got the taste for this now. When's my next booking? When can I get wrestling again? What's next?
That was literally it, yeah. That's literally it. I just want to get my teeth in it now. I want to get booked. I want to kind of get some more reps in, like I say, and just get myself out there. So, yeah, it's like you said, I'm happy to get that one out of the way. I had to get the first one out of the way, but just ready for more, man. Just ready for more, and just... happy to hear from anybody who would entertain a pirate on their show.
So we mentioned short term, what have you, but is there any promotions that you're got your eye on, got your non-glass eye on that you want?
Source, definitely Source. I had a great time there. The lads there are fantastic. Like even the ones that weren't in the match, like people came up to us after and gave us feedback. Lovely folk. So Source would be great to go back there. I've been to a few disco shows now, so it'd be great to end up there at some point. Reckless. There's loads, man. There's loads. I'd love to. Judas just made his debut at Wrestle Carnival, and from what I hear, he did a bloody excellent job. So good on him. But I'd love to go down there, and see kind of what I can do over there. So, New Japan Pro Wrestling. If anyone's listening from New Japan, I'd love to come on and show you what I can do. But no, man, like just happy to go anywhere at the moment. But want to get those reps in,
I mean, we do have like less than 1% on the anchor saying there's a Japanese listening contingent. So, you never know.
There we go. It could be a guy who knows a guy, right?
Exactly. Everyone knows everyone, I'm sure. Over there. I mean, it's got just a few million people, but I'm sure someone listens.
But they all know each other. They're all very friendly.
It's like when you go anywhere abroad and they go, from Scotland. They go, do you know my friend? He's from... Well, I'm in the Northeast, so I could pick anywhere really at this point. But do you know my friend in Wick?
Of course, aye. Is that Johnny? Aye, Johnny, aye.
You're just waiting for the day where it is actually someone you know, and you go, no, I do. I know that person. Oh, my God.
The exception that proves the rule, of course.
Yeah, exactly. But no, it's always a Johnny, and they're always in some arse end of nowhere. I mean, I'm in an arse end of nowhere, but like they're the other cheek in this arse. Right, so dream opponents. Then we'll go for that. So we do have a fantasy booking question at the end, which we'll get back to. But is there anyone out there right now that you're like, I want to see what Sharky Fossil can do against them?
On the UK wrestling scene, a fair few. I mean, Stone Malone. I'd love to get back in the ring with him now that he's a champion. I do, of course, hold a victory over him. So it'd be great to see what can be done there. I'm interested in getting back in the ring with Ian Skinner. Any of the guys from the school, really. Ian Skinner is great. Chez, for example. Guys like Zero. Guys like who else? There's loads. I'd love to face my coach at one point. That'll be great. Joe Hendry, Dave Conrad. So Honestly, there's so many names. I need to create some kind of a list, to be honest, and just you know, see if I can rattle through it in the span of my career. So so many, so much exciting talent on the scene right now. So just yeah, looking forward to getting in there with anybody and everybody.
Right. So I've realized we missed one of my amazing questions that I ask everyone. What would win in a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Oh man, I meant to do some thinking about this. Was it not proven by Leo that there isn't actual winner of this, right?
There is, and I didn't. Thank God I didn't reveal it on that episode, because it's a wonderful video. I still kind of watch every so often when I need to cheer myself up. anyone who hasn't yet, go into YouTube and search sheep versus cow fight, and it is worth 15 seconds of your life just to watch this happen.
I could just watch it now, but I could just keep you talking for 15 seconds. Two sheep, one cow. Cows are more vicious than sheep, I think. Like, sheep are just kind of passive. Cows have a bit of, you get bulls, right? So they're a bit more aggressive. So I think if two sheep came at a cow, it'd just like buck them into the sky. So they'd become like actual clouds, the sheep, you know, kind of thing. So yeah, I think that's how it would all pan out. Yeah.
Okay. That is your opinion, and your opinion only.
Yeah.
Two
sheep?
I've said since this question began, I've always believed in the two sheep. And I don't know if it's because I'm from the sticks up in the northeast, where sheep probably outnumber us now at this point.
You've got to be careful. Yeah.
I've always believed in the sheep. We've already had dolphins try to mess with our equipment here today. I don't want to get sheep involved either.
Not a surprise. Yeah, they're the worst. You got to be safe. And there is a horror film about sheep, isn't there? I remember.
It was Black Sheep, it was called, was it?
Maybe Black Sheep, yeah. Like, there's evil sheep and they're coming to kill humans. Yeah, that's right.
I'm just going to double check, because I'm a professional.
But Black Sheep sounds a bit right, yeah.
Black Sheep film. This could go all sorts of wrong. 2006.
Wow, what a classic.
Black Sheep. I think I had it on DVD. I got it in Poundland. I never watched it, and I think that's probably for the best.
Where can you go wrong with carnivorous human eating sheep? I mean, it's the perfect basis for a movie, right?
I mean, especially if you try and count them, you'll fall asleep and they'll eat your dreams. There you go. There's money just sitting ready to be made. Some Freddy Krueger sheep sort of thing going on.
You'll be fielding so many calls tomorrow based on that idea.
Absolutely. So I just go out June 6th. So June 7th, I will make sure that my phone is maybe on sound, not on silent.
That's it. Take it off vibrate. Yeah, exactly.
Just to make sure. Right. So yeah, well, fancy question. I always ask people to kind of finish up. Because I think, but it's one of those awkward things where we've done all this and we speak about all your wrestling matches, which is one. So we're just like, cool, what's next? But we've talked about it, though. You enjoyed it and you're ready to do more. Oh, froze on a little bit. You're back.
Yep, there we go.
Cool, that's fine. You're just frozen for a moment in time. This will be the fade out. This is a fade back in.
Yes, there we go. Perfect editing.
That's be done. And now we've made a joke of it. It stays in the episode. That's the terrible
thing.
Don't
you have to fade it out? Yeah, perfect.
Exactly. Yeah.
Long-term storytelling. That's what it is.
It's annoying because this is last like three episodes before yesterday's episode of recording. They'd all cut out in 10 minutes of the episode, and then I'd go back in, and then we continue the episode, and it's fine. This time, all the way through, and I think we're in the last maybe 10 minute stretch of this, and then it's cut out. So. Zoom
there we go.
Eats me.
That's fine. Yeah. Yeah.
bloody dolphins. Right.
Yeah. They're the worst.
So let's wrap up while the internet is still sort of stable. Fancy booking Vince McMahon. Actually, I don't know who runs New Japan, but the equivalent of Vince McMahon in New Japan. He has phoned you. He's got his translator on. And he said that you've got the main event of Wrestle Kingdom. So that is
sure.
You get in the main event, you get to pick your opponent or opponents on the match stipulation, anything you want. Mm-hmm. The only stipulation is they have to be alive, because it'll be very awkward otherwise. Who would you be wrestling? What's the match type?
Right, okay. Okay. Yes. It's a toss up between. I've already mentioned them. It's kind of boring, but John Moxley and Tomohiro Ishii. You know, it's got to be one of those guys. I would love to get in the room with either of them. You know, just have a good old brawl. You know, a good old brawl. So it wouldn't need to be any kind of specific match. Just you know, kind of hard hitting, strong style. You know, kind of match, which. If my cardio was there, would go a fairly long time. So let's say triple threat. Why not? We said triple threat for Shark Boy and Paul Burke show. So let's go triple threat for Moxley and Ishii. Yeah,
need to get a wee bit of rest while they're batting each other. All right,
exactly. Yeah, I can just watch and let them get to it, and then you know when they're all knackered, I can come in and just make them walk the plank. Yeah, easy
done, perfect. Well, like I say, we'll wrap up while my internet's still just about alive, but. Before we go, where can people find out more about Sharky Fossil or anything else you want to plug as we wrap up?
Yeah, sure. So Sharky Fossil is at Sharky Fossil on Twitter and on Facebook. You can find all about my pirate journey there. In regards to making kayfabe, my cover for my lamb lubberness, that is at Making Kayfabe. You can on Twitter and Instagram, you can search any podcast app and find Making Kayfabe on YouTube, etc. So you can find us there. But stay tuned with Sharky Fossil Making Kayfabe, and that is my plugs.
Excellent. Well, wonderful. And I think we've made it, haven't had to walk the plank, and think, and you've your land lubber lessons have went very well.
They've paid off. The amount of doubloons that went into those, honestly, you know, it's money well spent. But you know, it's quite tiring. You know, pretending to be a landlubber. So I'm looking forward to just getting back to normal. You know,
well, I'll leave you to relax and be swayed in the motion of the ocean. And
hey, Billy, thank you. Honestly, thank you for that. Asking me on for this, mate. It's a great podcast. I love listening to this show. You know, you've got a bloody brilliant thing here. Very sad it's ending, but very happy for you for the reason it's ending. So best of luck with that, mate. And honored to be a guest. So thank you so much.
Excellent. Thank you.